Philippine inflation could surpass 13-year highs in October as commodity prices continue to spiral. The central bank is projecting inflation to settle within 7.1% to a historic 7.9%. Socioeconomic Planning Chief Arsenio Balisacan also not expecting anything different given the disruptions caused by recent typhoons and continuing global headwinds. In September, inflation here in the Philippines quickened to 6.9%. That is the highest since October 2018. For his own outlook, we are now joined by economist and University of Asia and the Pacific Professor Bernardo Villegas. Dr. Bernie, good to see you. Welcome to Market Edge. Hi, sir.
Yes, thank you very much. Yes, good to see you too. Yes.
All right. Dr. Bernie, the fearless forecast is for inflation to have run hotter than expected in October. The BSP has it at 7.1 to 7.9 from September 6.9. Does that sound about right to you? Are we at peak already? What are you seeing?
I think that's right. Mm-hmm. And especially now with the damage done by the recent typhoon, food prices are really accelerating. So that's really a supply-driven type of inflation. But as we move towards the end of the year, first of all, as you're already watching, the central bank is becoming very aggressive in terms of increasing interest rates. And that will keep our exchange rate below definitely 60 pesos. Actually, my forecast for the end of the year is between 57 to 58. Mm-hmm. And that will definitely help to bring inflation down. Our cost of imports will definitely go down. Although we still have to see whether or not, for example, this coming typhoon, Queenie, will be as bad as Typhoon Pai. I mean, that's something that we cannot really forecast. Mm-hmm. So we have to keep our eyes open for more calamities. But if Typhoon Pai was the worst, then I see inflation receding to between 6 to 7% by the end of the year.
Mm-hmm. All right. So I guess the next question now, sir, is how much more pain the BSP will need to inflict to break inflation? I mean, a number of economists are saying 4.25% benchmark isn't exactly tightening. It's merely normalizing. What do you think?
I think we can go all the way up to 5. As I see that the central bank, under the leadership of Dr. Medalla, is really a lot more hawkish. And so it can be as high as 5%. And that is one thing that I see the central bank is very good at. So all the years, the central bank has been very, very effective in inflation targeting. They have all the tools necessary. And that's why I'm confident that they'll be able to bring down before the year end this inflation that we're now experiencing in October.
But Dr. Bernie, they say you can't tighten without breaking anything. If they break inflation, can it also break growth and recovery? I mean, higher rates will come at a cost. That could mean companies, you know, pulling back on expansion because the cost of borrowing is up, consumers spending less, holding off on buying big ticket items.
Oh, okay. So definitely, without this high inflation, I expected the economy to grow closer to 7%. With the inflation, I think it will slow down to 6.5%. But 6.5% is still one of the highest in this Indo-Pacific region. In fact, we're just neck to neck with Vietnam. Mm-hmm. Yes, it will definitely have a price, but especially with all the spending that you will see during Christmas holidays, coming especially from the remittances of our overseas workers who are increasingly generous, and not to mention the very bullish forecast of the BPO IT sector that may grow as much as 8 to 10% this year. Those are all dollar earnings that will be converted at 57 to 58. That also will infuse a lot of consumer spending. Mm-hmm. So I see consumer spending still leading the GDP growth this year.
So that's also good news for companies when you look at earnings, because earnings do matter. Well, we talk about all of these concerns about central bank tightening and all of these challenges with inflation. At the end of the day, they manifest in the corporate earnings that we see from companies like SM or the Ayalas or the Aboitises. Are you expecting corporate earnings to remain strong and resilient, sir?
Definitely. In fact, as we all know, our biggest engine of growth is consumer spending. 70% of our GDP is made up of consumption.
Mm-hmm.
As long as purchasing power is in the hands of 110 million Filipinos, those companies that are targeting the domestic market should do well profit-wise.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that's one of our advantages. In times of global crisis, we're not as affected by our neighbors, whose GDP may 140% of their GDP is in export, 80%. Ours is actually less than 30%. So when the world is in turmoil, we couldn't care less to a certain extent. We just sell to our 112 million consumers,
mm-hmm.
even admitting that 20% of them are too poor to buy too much. That's still close to 90 million middle-class people who are definitely now involved in revenge spending.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Dr. Bernie, you know, you've been fondly called or known as Dr. Boom, having predicted most, if not all, of the boom cycles as they approached us in the past. When you look at the cycles, and you did talk about, you know, 6.5% still very decent, very strong compared to peers. But are you seeing, when you look at the cycles, are you seeing another boom approaching us, maybe next year or 2024? And will this be felt across the board? I guess that is the most important question, because some people feel like they've been left out.
Well, at least in my forecast, I can guarantee a 6 to 7% in the next 5 years, which is just repeating what we were able to accomplish between 2011 and 2019 under two different leaders. 2011, 2016 was still Noy Noy. 2019, just before the pandemic, was already Duterte. Precisely because we already have reached a critical mass of strong institutions, central bank, NEDA, DOF, led by some of the best and the brightest that we have in the country. And we have had already a good number of economic reforms that corrected many of the policy errors we made in the past. And the one that I celebrate most was the passing of the public amendment of the Public Service Act, which now allows 100% foreign equity in some of the most strategic infrastructures that we need in the next 5 to 6 years to continue the build program. We know very well that our government cannot continue what the Duterte administration started, because our present government is saddled with huge debt. The only way we can continue the build is precisely to take advantage of that Public Service Act. And you can see President Marcos Jr. actually going all over the world telling foreign investors, now is the time to invest in airports, in telecom, in railroads, and so on and so forth. And that is where I am very bullish.
All right. Final question, sir. What keeps you up at night? You are very bullish indeed. What is worrying the Dr. Boom?
The agriculture sector. Yeah. And probably is also why I celebrate the president himself being the Secretary of Agriculture. Our agricultural sector has been actually declining and growing at most at 1% until we bring that rate at least to 3%, which is the average of our neighbors, I will not be able to rest. So I focus a lot on the, and I want to remind our audience that agriculture is not just farming. It's the whole value chain, post-harvest cold storage, logistics, processing. I want more and more Filipinos, especially among the young, to be very interested in investing in agribusiness.
All right. On that note, sir, Dr. Boom, thank you so much for joining us this morning. It was a pleasure speaking with you, Dr. Bernie. See you soon, sir.
Thank you very much.